Hello and welcome to another film in our series about the future of British woodlands and forests. There's a lot going on at the moment in the context of forestry and the wider environment. The England Tree Strategy is due to be launched any day. The Committee for Climate Change has recently published the sixth carbon budget. And the government is pulling together announcements for COP26 at the end of the year. And trees play a starring role in all of these forums. We're set in great store by the ability of trees to solve our problems, to absorb all the excess CO2 we're producing, to restore biodiversity levels. And we're hoping that wood from these trees will help to decarbonise construction, that fibre from the trees might replace plastics in the future. Now this is a lot to ask of a country with only 13% woodland cover, half of which is unmanaged, where planting rates fall well below government targets. Now, planting more trees and taking better care of the woodland we already have are obvious solutions. But what does that actually look like on the ground? I'm concerned that I see a lot of broadleaf and mixed woodland planting in this country that doesn't look well planned. It doesn't look healthy or cared for, and it certainly doesn't look like it's going to produce any kind of usable timber in the future. Am I right? Well, if I am, what does that mean for all the planting that's been done for the last 20 or 30 years? And how do we make sure that in the future we improve the quality of woodland creation? To find out what it takes to plant and care for a new woodland, I'm here in the Cotswold in the beautiful Bathurst Estate to meet Graham Taylor, who's Managing Director of Pryor and Rickett, professional forester and a squirrel expert.
Thanks for coming to Bathurst.
Well, tell us a little bit about where we are.
Right, well, we're standing amongst a very special stand, actually, on the Bathurst Estate. It's called a registered seed stand, and it's actually the start of the process.
And can you give me an idea, sort of summarise for me, the state of broadleaf woodland?
They're ageing. We've been planting a relatively modest amount over the last 20, 30 years to try and keep up the momentum, but there's a lot of fragmented woodland, there's a lot of unmanaged woodland. There's concerns about pest and disease, particularly things like the grey squirrel and deer causing an awful lot of ecological harm.
I'm hoping you're going to show me today some plots where planting has taken place.
Certainly am. Let's go and have a look at some now.
Okay. So where are we here?
We're just coming into a stand now, which was it's a small clearing in the forest. We had to fell this stand last summer because the trees were infected with ash dieback. And then, of course, you're faced with the importance to replant, to carry on the cycle. So it's a mix of conifer and broadleaves, mainly broadleaves. We've got oak and sycamore, some wild service, there'll be some lime and some shrubs as well. And then there's a small pocket of conifers. We foresters think a lot about replanting. It's the once in a lifetime, once in a generation or two, that you to get it right. Yeah. It comes down to two real fundamentals. One is tree planting density. If you, the basic minimum requirement was 1,100 stems per hectare. But if you plant 1,100 stems per hectare and then you don't look after them, you get this attrition. So you might lose 10 or 15% in your first year. And then by the end of year five, you might be down to 700-800 stems per hectare. The next part is maintenance. You need to look after them, nurture them, prune them a little bit, clean away the competition and make sure the original trees get away. But you overlay poor planning with poor maintenance and you end up with failure.
And I think you're going to show me a plot that hasn't gone so well, aren't you?
That's right. Yes, I am. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Lead the way. So where are we here then, Graham?
Well, we've come into another area of mixed woodland. It was an area that was felled about 10 or 12 years ago. Trees were planted and then no further maintenance took place. Lack of weeding has meant that some of the coppice has got up and away and has started to impact on the trees. So you get these curves, or particularly on the sycamore here and up through there. The other tree species in here that were planted, oak and beech, they've all suffered from a bit too much competition. And unfortunately, because of an absence of squirrel control, most of these species have been debarked at some stage up through the canopy. Depending on the degree of damage, they will carry on growing, but very suboptimally. Yeah. But two things particularly happen. One is you don't achieve the height that you ordinarily get for trees growing unimpeded. Now that matters in terms of carbon sequestration because as the total volume of the tree is diminished and the total canopy spread is diminished. But it also has an impact on what the stand itself can generate into the future. These instead of producing beautiful straight timber trees, which help perpetuate that sustainable cycle of forestry, this will produce very, very low grade firewood that barely covers the costs of planting initially. So you spend £5 or £10 per tree getting these things up and away, and you don't get that money back. You then get locked into a cycle of not producing enough revenue to pay for the maintenance of the woodland. Yeah. And why that matters really is because you need some money somewhere to deliver all of those things. You know, delivering good conservation costs money, good ride management, good ride edge management, protecting veteran trees, controlling pests, etc. All actually costs money, so you need to generate revenue from somewhere. And if all your crops, as it were, are getting damaged by squirrels, you just don't produce enough revenue to cover the costs of delivering those things. And then slowly but surely your conservation value and all your other benefits start to degenerate.
What proportion of the income of a landowner would come from timber sales versus grants and other streams of income?
Usually anything between 70 and 90% it comes from timber.
So if they don't manage to produce any timber from this, then or planting of this nature, they're going to have very little income going forward.
Very little income, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
You mentioned a bit about squirrels. And I know this is something very close to your heart, and they cause this kind of damage we're seeing in the tops of these trees. Can you explain a bit more about what they're doing in the woodland?
So we generally understand that they're after the phloem, which is the layer that's just under the bark. The reason they go after it, we think, is because there's not much food around just at that time of year when they do the damage. It's about midsummer. But why it matters is the impact on the growing tree. You can either get complete girdling of the leader and then this kind of forking, yeah. Which if you're trying to grow a beautiful tree for the long term, for the furniture industry or for carbon sequestration, you just end up with failure. But it's not just that. They also have a significant impact on the wider biodiversity across the woodland. So, you know, all creatures in a woodland environment are competing for food, for nest sites, and squirrels, because of the density that they live at, they have quite a big footprint on a woodland, ecological footprint, let alone the damage that they do to trees.
So they really are causing a lot of damage in broadleaf woodlands.
A huge amount of damage in broadleaf woodlands.
So we've kind of seen the bad, and now we're going to go and look at the good.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Graham, I've noticed walking around this estate just how straight so many of the trees are. You know, can you give us a bit of an insight into why that is the case here?
It's fundamentally the estate's been carrying out good forestry practice for multiple generations. So, and by doing so, not only do you produce something that's beautiful, you produce something that is useful. Both in the early stages, once this stand like that we're around now gets to first thinning stage, but thereafter it will continue to produce trees that are useful for a product, which helps with sequestration, helps with productivity and economic sustainability, and helps with underpinning all the benefits that the wood provides.
And tell me about a bit about what we're looking at
here. Okay, so what we're looking at here is again a mixed planting. It was oak, sycamore, there's some lime, some cherry and some ash. But it was planted with the right design, i.e. There were single rows here of oak in amongst a matrix. Each of these trees has been weeded in those early years to make sure they beat the weed competition. The coppice understory was cut where it needed to be to make sure it was under the tree and helping the tree grow upwards. And then over a period of years, it would have been selectively pruned to make sure you get that single leader taking you up. Bearing in mind that to achieve your 100-year-old tree that is relatively straight and useful for the timber market and therefore valuable, that's achieved by those processes. So we're now at the stage where we're just doing a little bit more pruning, and then we kind of feel like we're happy. The stand is set. It can go forward, you go through a whole series of thinning cycles to remove the poor quality, keep the best, remove the poor quality, keep the best over several decades. And then you start to see the stand develop into this beautiful, mature stand of oak.
Okay, so we established that, you know, this is what we want.
Yes.
The stand you took me to before is not what we want.
Yeah.
So how do we get more of this out there? You know, if we're going to be doing all this planting over the next few decades, this 20, 30,000 hectares a year, a lot of which is going to be broadleaf, how can we get more of this?
You need to do that early nurturing, that early maintenance, to get them to a stage where they are up and above the weeds, happy to keep going, starting to compete with each other. And even that competition is a really useful thing because it pushes the tree upwards. And with the upward growth, you get the form, you get the canopy development, and you start to then get that thing that's the desirable long term, which is having a beautiful, mature, high forest. There's a whole lot of correlations that one needs to understand about right tree, right species, right site. There's some really, really useful tools that the Forestry Commission provided called the Ecological Site Classification, where you can put a mark on a map and it'll come up with a whole list of species, conifer and broadleaf, that are right for that soil type. It's a really, really helpful tool.
Graham, we're in what I would consider to be a multi-purpose woodland. And we've talked quite a lot today about growing nice, tall, straight trees, which is a subject very close to my heart. Being a sawmiller, you know, we like good quality trees to produce timber from for buildings. But what are the other benefits that stem from tending and nurturing a woodland in this way?
There's a big association with actively managed woodlands and good quality biodiversity benefits. That's partly informed by, because foresters have learnt a lot of things over the last 30 years, and we're fundamentally interested in that kind of thing, but it's partly because the actions that we carry out, so good quality ride management, for example, increases light to the ride and creates good structure, which in turn is good for flowers, in turn good for insects, which in turn is good for birds. And so the one feeds off the other. If you're actively managing your woodland well, you're by default delivering good quality biodiversity.
So it's not a case then that you're going to have biodiversity or a productive woodland. What you're telling me is actually not only can you have both, but one can enhance the other.
One can enhance the other and one can feed off the other, and you get a multiplicity of gain.
Graham, we ask everyone that's been on these films with us what their hopes and fears are for the future.
Good question. So my hope, I think, would be that we solve the grey squirrel problem. If you ask every single lowland forester, the biggest irritation, frustration of their working life, without a shadow of doubt, it would be the damage that grey squirrels do to our array of broadleaf and some conifer tree species as well.
And your fears, what would they be?
Fear that we don't seem to learn from history. We know that we get grey squirrel damage and yet we haven't really solved that problem. We know that there's an array of diseases afflicting our species, and so we need to diversify. We haven't learned yet that 3 metre spacing is a bad idea. I could keep going, but those are probably the big three.
Not learning from the past.
Not learning from the past, okay. Yeah.
And if you had to make one policy suggestion to government, what would it be?
Put some serious investment into helping solve the grey squirrel problem. Grey squirrels will damage planted trees, they will damage naturally regenerated trees, they damage a wide array of our native species. And they fundamentally frustrate the kind of the woody economy from being the brilliant sustainable industry that it can be when we haven't got grey squirrel damage. Everything else we can kind of work with, but the grey squirrel can come in and ruin your work overnight.
So yeah. We really appreciate your time and sharing your immense knowledge of forestry. It's certainly been a school day for me. So should we go before we get rained on again?
Yeah, I think so.
Graham has taken us through the good and the bad of woodland creation today. And I've learnt a lot about silviculture and how it impacts upon the success of tree planting schemes. Now, I think we can all agree that we need more woodland cover in this country. But if we don't have a very sharp focus on quality and particularly on ongoing management, we'll waste this opportunity, not to mention a lot of taxpayers' money along the way. And it's important to be really honest.
and acknowledge the fact that tree planting in and of itself is not a solution to our problems. The creation of rich woodlands can contribute to sequestering CO2, restoring biodiversity levels, but that has to be the product of strategy, of planning, and of ongoing maintenance to nurture that woodland. And let's also not forget the really important input of professional foresters such as Graham, who are so often sidelined when forestry and tree planting are discussed in mainstream media. So I'd like to thank Graham again for the time he's given us today, because it's been a real learning day for us. That's it for another episode. So please keep watching our series and catch up with previous episodes on our YouTube channel. Thank you and goodbye.